Thank you. Disclosure. Speaker honorarium, no. Consulting fees, no. Other, none. This is not on the request of any industry. This is presenting some data that where a lot of confusion is about. Fruit and fruit juices in diabetes. You see the fruit on the top, and what comes out of it is the juice. And you would say, well, what is the difference between the two? And I'm going to try to do this. Now, there is good observational insight that the second speaker after lunch has a high risk of a sleepy audience. So I'll try to keep you awake by presenting some. If we talk about whole grain, the European Food Safety Agency says whole grain is poorly defined, because if you talk about whole grain bread, 90% of it may be wheat bread, and the other fractions is oat, rye, etc. So what do we talk about? And the same about fruit juices. What do we talk about?
Grape juice? No. Tomato juice? No. Carrot juice? No. Orange, yes, orange juice. Orange juice. Orange juice. Orange juice. Orange juice.
Oh. If Simon Liuzzi is he immediately starts dancing, you know. There is a lot of confusion. So what I want to say, if we talk about juice or epidemiological data of juice consumption, and juices are pooled, but most of the data is driven by orange juice. Yeah, keep that in mind. It's important. Some common statements. Sugars from juices are differently metabolized than sugars from fruit. The fact is that the molecular composition of sugars from fruit and their juices is exactly the same as is their digestion and absorption. And in your gut, there are no eyes to see what the food source is. What your gut cells see or sense is just a molecule. And whether it comes from the fruit or the juice, it delivers sucrose, glucose, and fructose, and finally glucose and fructose are being absorbed. There's no difference. Common statements. Juices are highly glycemic. Fact, juices are low to moderate glycemic. And if I tell this to people, say, you're kidding, this is highly glycemic. No, it's not true. If you look to these glycemic indexes, apple, orange, pineapple, etc., you see the fruit is relatively low to moderate GI, but the fruit juices also. They are not high glycemic. Common statement. In terms of health, there is no difference between soda and juice, especially, yeah, there are some people that are telling this on the internet. Juice is just as bad as soda. In fact, juice and soda differ much in nutrient content and also in their health effects. If you look to this table here, you see orange juice I made blue, and Coca-Cola I made red at the bottom, and you see there is a comparison according to sugars that are there, but there are a lot of nutrients in the juices that certainly are not in the sodas. So our fruits good and our juices bad for health? That is something that I want to talk about. We know that increasing fruit consumption is recommended for better health. That is global in all the dietary recommendations, you see that. But what is taken away, as soft drinks do, fruit juices cause overweight and diabetes, simply because they are a source of sugars. The question then is, well, show us the data. Where are the data that this is true? Are there any correlations? Is there anything about cause and effect evidence that we should know? And what do the currently available recommendations and data really tell us then? Health effects of sugar-sweetened beverages. Many epidemiological studies, they all come to the same conclusion. Sugar-sweetened beverage consumption is related to increased health risk, overweight, diabetes, cardiovascular disease. But analysis shows a very large heterogeneity in the definition of sugar-sweetened beverages. There are big differences, just as in whole grain or just as in fruit juice. What do we talk about? Example, sugar-sweetened beverages are soft drinks, fruit drinks with added sugars, and fruit juices without added sugars. They're all pooled together in some epidemiological studies. So what do we talk about? In some cases, a category soft drinks was even defined to include also drinks sweetened with artificial non-caloric sweeteners. You can find those examples in the literature. No sugars, but still it's sugar-sweetened beverages. In another case, also sugar-sweetened dairy drinks were included in the sugar-sweetened beverages. So what do we talk about? And the takeaway of that is that any conclusion related to disease risk of defined drink clusters do not allow any statement about the effect of individual drinks. Yeah, we should look to individual drinks. Now, if you look to the recommendations, there's evidence from sugar-sweetened beverages that is cited throughout many documents, and you see here association between increased intakes of added sugar, sugar-sweetened beverages, and other sugar-sweetened beverages. The right one, sugar-sweetened beverage, increase of dental caries, etc. You see that, and from that, we see a takeaway to the fruit juices. You see the WHO reduction of free sugars, which includes then also the fruit sugars. Yeah, the fruit sugars are defined as free sugars here. Second in Great Britain, reduced free sugars, including fruit juice. And on the right one, the International Diabetes Federation. Yeah. Nature, okay, a guideline to reduce the consumption of foods naturally high in sugar content, certain fruits and fruit juices. Now, this is interesting. So let's look at the data. What do they really tell us? If we talk about fruit, very clear. There is very good data that increasing fruit consumption is beneficial. Very nice paper from Morocco. 187,000 participants, more than 3 million persons of follow-up. 12,000 participants developed type 2 diabetes. What was looked upon was the consumption of apple, orange, grapefruit, and other juices, and 10 types of fruits that you see listed here. Now, they come to certain conclusions. First of all, they question whether all fruits and juices are equal. They clearly show that fruit consumption lowers diabetes risks, but individual fruits may not be equally associated with the type of risk type 2 diabetes, just as certain grains may differ. Fruits have highly variable content of fiber, antioxidants, sugars, etc., which jointly may influence disease risk, and the carbohydrate quality, glycemic index, or glycemic load may also differ. Fruit juices, of course, also then differ according to the original fruits. And what they found was that replacing 3 servings per week of fruit juice with the same amount of total or individual fruits, and then you see the fruits, reduces the risk of diabetes. And they make a nice plot, and you see the plot here on the next slide. This is the reduction if you replace juice by the fruits. And you see here, fruits types differ. And the possible layman's takeaway then may be fruits are beneficial and juices are bad, because if you exchange them, and this is calculation, this is modeling, then you see this effect. But you could say, well, are they really bad then in such a comparison? A publication of Lee about fruit and vegetable intake and the risk of type 2 diabetes. Yeah? 10 studies covering 13 comparisons, more than 400,000 participants, more than 24,000 cases of type 2 diabetes. And what they show is that if you look to the fruit, you see on the left side that there is a beneficial effect. And if you look to the vegetables, there is a beneficial effect on diabetes risk. It is on the good side of the line. Now, this is fruit. Then you can say, well, what about fruit juices? Publication of Wang, 2012, orange juice consumption and energy intakes and body composition. And this is an important one because the two determine diabetes risk indirectly. Orange juice consumers at least once in 2 non-consecutive 24 hours. They looked at 100% orange juice, pure orange juice, non-sweetened 100% or non-sweetened with added calcium and vitamin D, as is in the market. And non-orange juice consumers were the control group. If you look to what they conclude is that orange juice consumption was associated with a healthier body composition in adults, as expressed by lower BMI and body fat and waist circumference. There were no signs, significant associations between orange juice consumption and body composition in children, nor in adolescents. Then you can say, well, this is okay. But then does it potentially drive on the long term maybe diabetes by impacting on other factors? Xi, 2014, intake of fruit juice and incidence of type 2 diabetes. Results, 4 studies with more than 190,000 participants, including sugar-sweetened fruit juice. So fruit juice to which additional sugars have been added. And 4 studies, about 140,000 participants of 100% pure fruit juice without added sugars. They found that a higher intake of additional sugars in drinks increased the risk of type 2 diabetes, but intake of 100% fruit juice was not associated with an increased risk. That says something about additional sugars in solution, just as with sugar-sweetened beverages. Soft drink, 100% fruit juice, and vegetable juice intakes and risk of diabetes, ESHAC. They looked in Japanese men and women. 484 men and women reported newly diagnosed diabetes during 10 years of follow-up. High soft drinks intake increased the risk of diabetes in women, but not in men. Now, you may raise the question, why would that be? But again, 100% juice consumption had no effect. Conclusions, consumption of soft drinks but not pure juices was associated with increased risk of type 2 diabetes in Japanese men and women. Then you can say, well, if there is no effect, just like the previous speaker showed that you may have no effect of whole grain consumption on fasting blood glucose, but if its insulin is changed, it says something about your insulin sensitivity. So what's happening here? No change, but might insulin sensitivity be influenced? Wang 2014, effective fruit juice on glucose control and insulin sensitivity meta-analysis. Now, if you look to the fasting glucose, you see there is virtually there is no effect of the fruit juices, 100% fruit juices on fasting glucose. If you look to insulin, it appears to be a little bit left from the line, so you could say, well, maybe at least there is very small effect. It is more or less neutral. This meta-analysis showed that fruit juice may have no overall effect on fasting glucose and insulin concentration, and more RCTs are warranted to further clarify a cause-effect ratio association between the fruit juice and the glycemic control. And if we do that, we need to have one type of fruit juice and look to these parameters after regular consumption over a prolonged period of time. Now, many observational studies show correlations, but no causality. What we see is that 100% juice consumption is related to a healthier lifestyle. Effect of multiple lifestyle factors may induce mutual synergistic effects, and a cause-effect relation can also be only be shown in randomized controlled placebo studies. And Murphy recently, in 2017, very nice publication, addressed this issue. Come on, you see the publication here, systematic review and meta-analysis in the Journal of Nutritional Science. You see the data from this meta-analysis, 100% fruit juice, fasting blood glucose. It is on the good side. There is a slight reduction. If you look to fasting insulin, there is no effect. And if you look to HOMA-IR, there is no effect at all. So the conclusion there is that available RCT with repeated intake of 100% juice show no effect on glycemic control or insulin resistance. Stratified analysis and univariate meta-regression show no significant associations between fruit juice consumption, 100% fruit juice consumption, and glucose control. Findings are consistent with observational studies that 100% fruit juice is neutral regarding the risk of type 2 diabetes. So in terms of should we tell people not to consume 100% fruit juice? I would say there are no data to support the suggestion not to do so. But there may be a risk if you go to very high consumptions. Non-published data yet of Khan, he addressed this morning briefly, but here 84 cohort comparisons, and if you look to the data, then you see that the sugar-sweetened beverages, as with all other studies, and the sweetened fruit drinks with additional sugars are on the bad side. The mixed fruit juice is close to the line. Then you see 100% fruit juice equal to fruit is around the zero line. So there is almost no effect also here in these studies. Then you can say, well, if there are beneficial effects, what might then make the difference between sugar-sweetened beverages and the fruit juices? Well, there is some link to flavonoids, and flavonoids may impact on various factors. This publication is just out from Germany, 2018, and it shows that plant-based diet quality may appear to be an important factor. A higher daily flavonoids intake with fruit juices and vegetables during adolescence is relevant for the prevention of type 2 diabetes in later life. That is what they showed. And they showed that apples, red cabbage, strawberry, grapes, and orange juice were the most important intakes in this particular study. Very nice study of Oruwama, 2012, goes into these mechanisms for anyone who wants to see this. Now, two last slides. Lots of marketing for children.
Do you like orange juice? Do you like orange juice? Do you like orange juice? Yes, I do. Do you like spider juice? Do you
like spider juice? It goes on. But this is for children. And I would say if you look to the data, there's clear data that if you give daily orange juice or daily juices, children of very young age, and then I talk below 4 years of age, that it is linked to increased dental damage and increased obesity as well in these children. So what do the data show us then? Fruit sugars and sugars are not metabolized differently. Orange juice provides a wide range of micronutrients and fruit-derived plant bioactives that fit well in a healthy diet. Daily moderate amounts of 100% orange juice have no impact on weight gain, diabetes, and heart disease. Consumers that use 100% juice appear to be leaner, more insulin sensitivity, and have less metabolic syndrome. Probably linked to other factors that are linked to a healthy lifestyle. Yeah, they cluster together. We see exactly the same with whole grain consumers, by the way. Juices should not be seen as thirst quenchers. So accordingly, it should only be consumed in small amounts, equivalent to one or two pieces as we eat them. And that is about one little glass, champagne glass of orange juice. And that is what I tell parents, make it special to your kid. Give the orange juice in a champagne glass. And that's it. Yeah. Young children should not be given juice as healthy alternative to water. And above all, consuming a blend of whole fruit is recommended above all. Okay, this was my last slide. If you have any questions, you can ask me later. Thank you.